Thank you. We all know our wear and tear in our everyday lives. About 200 years ago, a scientific report stated that steel has a very high potential to harden and hence very high wear resistance. Since then, many steels are developed for wear resistance applications based on hardness alone. However, there are some other reports stating that we need to look beyond hardness alone. So today I will speak about metallurgical aspects of steels designed for a particular types of wear, abrasion and impact abrasion wear. Abrasion is the removal of the material from the surface when subjected to tangential loads against hard particles. Whereas impact abrasion is a combination of both impact loads as well as abrasion loads. So we'll start with a simple example in wear, because wear is a system property that depends on many parameters in the entire wear process. So to take a simple example of transportation of material in lifting and excavation industry, during the loading, the truck body exposes to impact loads, the same surface exposes to abrasion. Because of the sliding of the material during unloading. So the surface, the wear loss of this, from the surface is a combination of both impact as well as abrasion. So it can be even more complex if you include the corrosion and other wear other damaging mechanisms. So therefore, the designing requires, when steels are designed, you need to look beyond, need to look beyond one mechanical property. So we see the present status of development of materials, mainly for abrasion, is based on hardness. Because when tested at laboratory scale for abrasion resistance, the steels show increase in wear resistance with the increase in brittle hardness. However, when the same steels are tested under impact abrasion, there is hardly any correlation with the wear rate and brittle hardness number. So therefore, there's a need to look beyond hardness, and also we have the field test results show that this is the result of wear loss results of steel tools used in ceramic industry. The data is scattered, however, overall, there is a decrease in wear loss with increase in hardness, but there is no linear correlation as expected from the laboratory results. Here is the test results of a low impact abrasion test. The data clearly shows there is no linear relations from over the range of hardness tested for the wear resistance. So, based on study reports published from the field as well as laboratory results, what is evident is that once the hardness is above 500 Vickers hardness, the returns on increasing wear resistance are diminishing. Why is this? There are some reports claiming that the wear resistance mainly better correlate with the surface hardness during the wear test. That's after abrasion, the hardness is increases, and there is a better correlation with the wear resistance. So Richardson done a very clever experiments by studying the various types of steels by deforming the surface various mechanisms like short peeling and burnishing the tool with the tool steels. Here the results show only for the steels with the increase in initial hardness against initial hardness. So though it is in the hindsight it is known that hardness obviously increase in hardness decreases with the hardness. But what is clear is that once it reaches about 500 or 400 Vickers hardness, the increase in from the initial hardness is minimal. So probably this explains why once the hardness is about 500, the work hardening is very minimal, and then maybe the wear resistance is very less. Any damage mechanism definitely includes a fracture from the removal of asperities to the large scale of debris. So in a way, the fracture toughness should play a role. However, there are very few literature reports including the fracture toughness in studying wear resistance. There is one general correlation between wear resistance and hardness with the fracture toughness. The underlying assumption here is that hardness and fracture toughness are inversely related. That is, increase in hardness decreases the fracture toughness. What is evident from here is that at a low fracture toughness, the wear resistance is very low, and at a high fracture toughness, again wear resistance is low. That's where the hardness is very. At a high fracture toughness, that's where the hardness is low. Again, wear resistance is low. In between, there's a design. It is controlled by both the fracture toughness and hardness. Hornbusen developed a model to include a model based on Archer's equation. And he developed three designs, ductile design and a brittle design. Ductile design, where it is completely controlled by its hardness, and a brittle design is where it's completely controlled by its fracture toughness. And there is a transition region between the brittle and ductile. That's where both fracture toughness and hardness play a key role. So, based on the model, it is found that the wear volume is inversely related to square of fracture toughness. So, when the metal is not too brittle, like it's ceramics, and not too when it's not too tough, then the wear rate varies inversely with the fracture toughness. When the material is removed from the surface, quite a lot of energy is put into the material. So the based on many models and calculations, it showed that 95% of energy mainly consumed in the deformation and structural changes. Structural changes like if there is some amount of retained austenite, some energy is required to transform retained austenite to martensite. After deforming to great extent, the metal is removed, requires only small, very minor amount of energy. Therefore, ductility definitely play a role in increasing, in controlling the wear resistance. For example, the same steels. The results of wear resistance against hardness can be also correlated with the strain to fracture. These are at a laboratory test, however. There are reports to show better correlation at a field test to a combination of strain to fracture and hardness. So, therefore, there is a need to study. Not only hardness and also ductility and other mechanical properties, and correlate better with the wear resistance. My structural constraints are mainly the steels. Majority of the steels are mainly medium carbon martensitic steel, either in quenched or quenched in tempered condition. I think that's mainly because the feasibility of producing them in the conventional mills. These steels are martensitic steels, mainly in the quenched and tempered conditions, are easy to produce through plate mills or conventional strip mills. They're basically produced to increase the high hardness. In recent times, there are some laboratory test results to show that carbide free bayonet steels perform better than the martensitic steels because of presence of a very fine plates of bayonet and alternate layers of bayonet and arsenide stable arsenite without any carbides. When it comes to the role of arsenite, the results are not conclusive. Some reports claim, especially reports on hard-filled steels, claim that when the steel, hard-filled steel was subjected to abrasion conditions, there is an increase in wear resistance due to presence of arsenite. However, when the same steel was subjected to severe plastic deformation, there is hardly any improvement in hardness. In fact, there is a deterioration of wear resistance. And also, it depends on the conditions of loading conditions when it comes to the arsenite. When the medium carbon steel was subjected to two different types of loading conditions, very low impact and high impact. When it's subjected to, however, after loading conditions, both these steels have similar amount of martensite, but different hardness levels. At low loading conditions, the dislocations and very fine, thin striking parts are formed, whereas at high impact loads, the twins are very wider and increased dislocation islands, increased dislocation density. Because of this, hardness in this case is much higher than the low loading conditions, despite a similar amount of retained arsenite transformed to the martensite. Therefore, when designing the steels with the retained arsenite, it also depends on the kind of applications that's being tested. So, what is evident definitely from the foregone discussion is that the role of fracture toughness is important and they need to be studied. So, due to Matthew et al., there's a steel has been developed with a very high fracture toughness and hardness that has been produced about 300 tons at a pilot scale level. The steel is very hard and also tough because of its very refined prior arsenite grain size. That resulted in very fine laths of a martensite. So the same steel can be reheated to high temperature, but to destroy the elegant microstructure and then form a very large arsenite grains and then punch to room temperature. That will result in a similar level of hardness, but a very poor toughness. So that can be studied, both the steels can be studied to bring out the role of fracture toughness and quantify the fracture toughness and also validate the previous models on fracture toughness. As the role of retained arsenite is not clearly conclusive, the carbide-free Bennett steels or the martensite steels with certain amount of arsenite can be tempered to remove the retained arsenite, and then both the before and after treatment steels can be tested together so that role of arsenite can be clearly brought out. There are many laboratory and field test data for various types of steels, but the correlation is mainly based on the hardness, but if the other parameters like composition, ductility and other mechanical properties, yield strength and tensile strength are included, then a neural network model is feasible to bring out the better correlation with all other mechanical properties. So what is evident from the published literature is that once the wear strength of the steel, once the hardness of the steel is above 500 Vickers hardness, the wear strength is limited by the fracture toughness and over hardening due to ability of the material to absorb the energy below the subsurface. So there is definitely a need of quantifying the fracture toughness as discussed, there is a way, especially when steels are required for high-end applications where hardness is very very high hardness materials are required. The carbide-free Bennett steels are promising at laboratory stage. However, there is a need of field testing of carbides. Field testing of the steels are required to see whether really performing better under those conditions. However, the major challenge is to produce them commercially at a plant level. It's also one thing that needs to be seen. Thank you.
Thank you.